The world that Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart entered unceremoniously in 1756 was awash in change. Historians refer to this era as the Age of Enlightenment, one of unparalleled scientific, philosophical, and political ferment. Within Mozart's lifetime, it set in motion forces that would fundamentally alter life not only in his native Salzburg, but around the globe. Enlightenment philosophers, such as Jean-Jacques Rousseau, argued that man was by nature good, and that power rested in a society, not in its rulers. Granting the impossibility of returning to a pre-societal age of innocence, Rousseau advocated an educational system in which each person's moral and intellectual potential could be fully realized. François Voltaire was an even more passionate advocate of the Enlightenment. Devoted to principles of fairness and justice, Voltaire spent his life writing satirical attacks on the abuses of power. The deity in which he professed belief was one based on reason rather than faith. The Enlightenment was not, to be sure, a democratic movement. In France, the absolutism of the Sun King, Louis XIV, continued under Louis XV and XVI. But in Austria, Empress Maria Theresa introduced a greater measure of tolerance and freedom among her subjects, laying a foundation for the democratic revolutions that followed. Salzburg, in western Austria, belonged to a region of breathtaking beauty long before The Sound of Music was filmed. As a semi-sovereign principality within the sprawling Holy Roman Empire, Salzburg was ruled by an archbishop who served both as a clerical and secular leader. Conservative Catholicism was tempered by Enlightenment values. Wolfgang's father Leopold came from a family of Augsburg bookbinders. He received a solid Jesuit education, more intellectual than evangelical. Even owning two microscopes, a telescope, a globe, and an atlas. After a year at the Benedictine University in nearby Salzburg, Leopold stopped attending classes to pursue a career as a musician. Settling in Salzburg, Leopold served over four decades as a court musician to five archbishops. In 1756, the year that Wolfgang was born, Leopold published the first edition of his Violin School, which soon brought him international fame. In 1800, more than a dozen years after Leopold's death, his treatise was still being reprinted. Wolfgang's mother, Anna Maria, brought as much talent to her 32-year marriage as did Leopold. Her father, Wolfgang, was widely admired as a bass singer and choir master. Though deprived of a formal education, she was highly intelligent and quick-witted, qualities that attracted the sober and reserved Leopold. Only two of their seven children survived infancy. Wolfgang's musically talented sister, Nannerl, was 5 years older. Yet in this painting, the 12-year-old looks like a spinster of 70, complete with incipient double chin. Wolfgang, too, looks far older than his 7 years and controls the action from his place at its center. Indeed, Mozart marks the beginning of the Western fascination with the child prodigy. Dressed in the festive outfit given Wolfgang in 1762 by the Empress Maria Theresa, this boy of not quite 7 years old looks for all the world like a miniature adult who has simply skipped childhood. In a style of representation that became popular after his death, the young Mozart is a miniaturized replica of his father. According to the anecdote that this scene almost certainly represents, Leopold returned home with the trumpeter J.A. Schachner to discover his little 5-year-old son hard at work on a keyboard concerto. Other 19th-century artists represented Wolfgang, variously said to be anywhere from 11 to 14 in this engraving, as a curly-locked angel. For them, how else could the divine music that poured out of a child-sized body be explained? The idealization of Mozart's genius was complete by the end of the 19th century. In this anonymous French painting, Mozart composes with his violin in one hand, and music has appeared miraculously on his stand in the other. The message is unmistakable. Mortals use quills. Mozart simply wills. The temptation to take his two prodigies on the road proved irresistible to Leopold, who assumed sole responsibility for Mozart's education. Between 1762 and 1766, the Mozarts appeared at almost every major court in Europe. Wolfgang dazzled audiences with his ability to read difficult music at sight and to improvise. When he was six, Mozart played for Maria Theresa at her summer palace in Schönbrunn. On a tour of the apartments given by the Empress, Mozart slipped and fell to be helped up by Marie Antoinette. That one. After proposing marriage to Marie, he jumped up on the Empress's lap, threw his arms around her, and kissed her warmly. The Mozart stayed longest in London. In 1763-64, they remained for 15 months. Early on, they met King George III and Queen Charlotte. Where is the 10-year-old in this painting of tea time at Prince Conti's? Seated at the harpsichord, Mozart differs from the three adults behind him only in his size, shrunk to doll-like proportions. In London, as elsewhere, the Mozarts hobnobbed with the leading musicians. Probably the most important of these was Johann Christian Bach, the youngest son of Johann Sebastian. It is no accident that Mozart's early symphonies, composed in London, are often stylistically indistinguishable from those of J.C. Bach. Whether Mozart was 11 or 14 when this portrait was painted, his prowess as a keyboard player, violinist, improviser, and composer were already legendary. From 1768 to 1775, between stays in Salzburg, he and Leopold made three further forays to Italy and Germany. Wolfgang evolved from a prodigy into a serious composer. The Mozart, who at age 14 had received the Order of the Golden Spur from the Pope, found the provincial atmosphere of Salzburg increasingly stifling. He longed for a job in a more challenging environment. In 1777, the 21-year-old Mozart demanded his release from the service of the Archbishop Hieronymus Colloredo. Offended by Mozart's arrogance, the Archbishop offered both Wolfgang and his father their release. But Leopold could scarcely afford to give up his position with the court. Humiliated, he was retained on condition that he curtail his travels. Wolfgang's determination to find the job worthy of his talents only deepened. With Leopold confined to Salzburg, Mozart and his mother undertook an arduous journey in 1777 to Munich, Mannheim, and Paris. No suitable offers materialized, and they lived in impoverished conditions in Paris, while Wolfgang tried to interest indifferent Parisians in his music. A discouraged Anna Maria died there on July 3, 1778. Mozart was induced by his father to return to Salzburg, although he dragged out the journey to 6 months. In Munich, he was spurned in love by the singer Aloysia Weber, but this passing hurt paled in comparison to Mozart's frustrated ambition, especially to compose operas, the 18th century analog to our movies. Back home, Mozart thought about little except how to escape Salzburg. When an invitation to compose an opera for Munich arrived in 1780, he couldn't leave quickly enough. There he wrote Idomeneo, his first great opera. In the many letters to his father, he makes no effort to contain his excitement at being challenged and appreciated. In a move whose ramifications he could not have appreciated, the Archbishop then summoned Mozart to Vienna to participate in the festivities surrounding the coronation of Joseph II. When it came time, Mozart could not bring himself to leave, and in an acrimonious encounter with the Archduke's representative, he was booted out. Although Mozart had visited Vienna as a youth, he now viewed himself as a mature composer, able to make it on his own. And what city but the imperial capital was big enough to absorb a talent as big as his? With almost 200,000 inhabitants and a lively music publishing trade, Vienna could legitimately claim to be the musical capital of Europe. Located in a windswept plain a safe distance from the often-flooded Danube River, the old city was fortified by a circular wall closed on one end by a flood canal. In the 18th century, Vienna was considerably newer than other European capitals. Most of the city had been laid waste during the siege of the Turks in 1683. As a result of its earlier devastation, the dominant architectural style in Vienna is Baroque, aided in the 1700s by an influx of Italian sculptors, stucco workers, and painters. The dominant architect and architectural historian was Italian-trained Johann Fischer von Erlach, whose densely decorated structures still stand out today. Parts of the city retained the Gothic windows and pointed turrets of medieval times. As the population mushroomed, small shops sprang out from the sides of buildings along Vienna's spacious Italian-style squares. A rebuilt St. Stephen's Church at the heart of the old city continued to serve as Vienna's moral compass. To the left of the great church door, the city fathers set in cement an iron rod exactly the length of a Viennese yard. Consumers who had just purchased cloth or other measurables could verify their length. The New Market was typical of the squares that sprang up in 18th century Vienna. Shoppers could buy fresh produce in the open-air stalls. The Schwarzenberg Palace in the background was the scene of one of Mozart's childhood performances. The restaurant Zur Mehlgrube on the left was also used for dances and amateur concerts. During the first half of the 18th century, many of Vienna's wealthy aristocrats erected spacious palaces. The Viennese embraced any festive occasion, such as the arrival of Prince Eugene of Savoy in 1711, to organize a procession. It was Eugene's skillful diplomacy that freed Vienna from both Turkish and French military threats. Outside the city walls were estates such as the Belvedere, whose property was acquired by Prince Eugene in 1693. Between 1700 and 1725, he installed lavish gardens, a summer home, the Lower Belvedere, and a reception hall, the Upper Belvedere. The three-quarters of a mile north to the inner city was essentially a flat, open plain. Although Vienna teemed with music, there were no public spaces designated for musical performance. Moreover, instrumental concerts, known as academies, could only take place during the 6 weeks of Lent, when opera and full-scale theatrical productions were banned. The Burgtheater was a popular choice for these infrequent musical events. So was the Theater an der Wien, where in the decades following Mozart's death, Beethoven premiered the Eroica Symphony, the Violin Concerto, the Pastoral Symphony, and his only opera, Fidelio. Mozart's father objected strongly to his son's plan to strike out on his own. The last straw was Wolfgang's announcement in 1782 that he was going to marry Constanze Weber, the older sister of the singer who had rejected him earlier. But Wolfgang held firm, and by all accounts his marriage was warm and affectionate. Constanze was pregnant for much of their 9-year marriage. Like Mozart's family, only two of Wolfgang and Constanze's children survived infancy. As is generally the case with the offspring of geniuses, the genetic convergence to mediocrity ensured that their musical talents were meager. In Freemasonry, Mozart found a wider family, an expression for many of his egalitarian ideals. Although Freemasonry, begun in England and Scotland, was to become the largest secret society in the world, its ideals embraced tolerance and political compromise. Mozart was often asked to provide music for his lodge's celebrations. A self-confident Mozart assured his father in 1782 that he would be able to support a wife and family in Vienna, which he called Klavierland. He planned to achieve this by writing music for the public, operas, symphonies, and concertos featuring himself as pianist. Although public performances were less frequent than today, they were for that reason on a more lavish scale. In spite of intrigues raised against him, Mozart managed to present The Abduction from the Seraglio in 1782. Of its success, he wrote proudly to his father, "People are crazy about this opera, and it does me good to hear such applause." For the first few seasons, Mozart enjoyed an intoxicating popularity among the Viennese. In a series of academies attended by almost 300 supporters and patrons, he unveiled a string of masterful piano concertos. Emboldened by his success, he moved his family to the best part of town. Mozart tried to take advantage of the emerging entrepreneurial opportunities in Vienna. Four of his operas, The Abduction from the Seraglio, The Marriage of Figaro, Don Giovanni, and Così fan tutte, were premiered or performed in the prestigious Burgtheater. But the Viennese were not disposed to settle on one composer for long, even one whose talents dwarf those of all others. Figaro, begun in October 1785, only 9 months after the completion of the C major string quartet, provides an instructive example. The play by Beaumarchais had been banned shortly after its Parisian premiere in 1784. And no wonder. It pit the upper and lower classes against each other in a battle of wits. The aristocratic count comes off as an arrogant fool compared to his clever servant Figaro. Mozart viewed this scenario as the basis for a surefire hit. With a brilliantly adapted libretto from his collaborator Lorenzo da Ponte, Mozart created a glittering musical score. The May 1786 premiere was a critical success, yet Figaro was withdrawn after only 9 performances. Not until he took his opera to Prague the next year did Mozart encounter the enthusiastic acclaim that we take for granted. To a Viennese friend, Mozart described a festive ball in Prague. "I watched with greatest delight while all of these people whirled about in delight to the music of my Figaro. For here they talk about nothing but Figaro. Nothing is played, blown, sung, or whistled but Figaro. No opera attended like Figaro, forever Figaro." By 1787, Mozart's star in Vienna had begun to set. In Peter Schaffer's play Amadeus, Mozart's failures are attributed to an infantile personality and the intrigues of court composer Antonio Salieri. But there is no evidence that either of these wonderful dramatic conceits were true historically. Indeed, Mozart and Salieri were on cordial terms. In spite of Mozart's efforts to secure a steady source of income, the most he ever managed was an appointment as a minor court composer to Emperor Joseph II. In practice, that meant he was called upon occasionally to produce dances for official balls. Mozart observed that he was paid too much for what I do, too little for what I could do. Like many Viennese composers before him, Mozart strove to augment his income by publishing works for home consumption. In earlier times, secular music had been composed for the entertainment of aristocrats, generally by other aristocrats. The rise of an urban working class now offered families of modest means the opportunity to take up music. A thriving trade in music for amateurs sprang up during the 18th century, especially in Germany and Austria. Like a pickup basketball game today, amateur music making assumed no audience. There were as yet no fixed instrumental groupings. A single ensemble might include strings, woodwinds, brass, and even voices. Mixed ensembles were gradually challenged by the growing popularity of the newfangled forte piano, an instrument similar to the harpsichord in all but one crucial respect. Its strings were struck rather than plucked, allowing for continuous gradations of loud and soft. Most Viennese families of any means aspired to own one. But until at least 1800, the ambition of the most cultivated amateurs in Vienna was to excel on a string instrument, such as the violin. Unlike keyboard players, and more so than woodwind or brass players, string players must possess highly refined hearing and perfect arm control to play even a single note in tune. The instrumental combination that came to command the most prestige among performers and composers was the string quartet, a balanced ensemble of 2 violins, a viola, and a cello. The composer who sparked its development was Franz Joseph Haydn, a circumstance fully appreciated by an admiring Mozart. We do not know the occasion on which Mozart first encountered Joseph Haydn, though it was almost certainly around 1781, possibly at one of the gatherings organized by Baron von Swieten to hear the music of J.S. Bach. At 50, Haydn was twice Mozart's age. By now, he was also at least twice as well known. Mozart had known Haydn's music for at least 10 years. In Haydn, he not only found a composer whose achievements were on a level with his own, but a warm and sympathetic friend in whom he could confide. This contrasted strongly with the strained relationship that Mozart enjoyed with his father. Haydn was still officially in the employ of the Esterházy family in Western Hungary, but during the 1780s he made an increasing number of trips to Vienna. Although his and Mozart's presence at the same event can be verified only a few times, contemporary engravings suggest that he was a welcome guest of Mozart and his wife. Haydn's Opus 20 quartets of 1772 may have provided models for the quartets that Mozart wrote over the next 2 years. In late 1781, Haydn published in Vienna a set of 6 highly original quartets, Opus 33, that probably inspired Mozart to begin his own set of 6. The last of the set, the C major quartet, was finished in January 1785. We can only imagine the evening in February 1785 when Mozart invited several friends to his spacious lodgings in the Domgasse to play through the 3 newest quartets. The audience of 3 included Mozart's father Leopold, now reconciled to his son's independence. With Wolfgang on viola, his dear friend Haydn played first violin. Karl Ditters von Dittersdorf, that's his real name, probably played second violin. Dittersdorf was 17 years Mozart's senior, yet outlived him by 8 years. Best known as a composer of symphonies and operas, his official post was as Kapellmeister to a prince bishop, about 100 miles outside of Vienna. The Czech composer Johann Baptist von Hall probably played cello. Von Hall, the same age as Dittersdorf, lived to be almost 75. Without benefit of an appointment, he worked as an independent composer in Vienna. In the same year that Mozart's new quartets appeared, von Hall published 6 quartets of his own. During that historic evening, Haydn remarked to Leopold, "Your son is the greatest composer known to me in person or by name. He has taste and, what is more, the most profound knowledge of composition." For his part, Wolfgang dedicated his new quartets to Haydn in language that captures the special relationship between two musical geniuses. A father who had decided to send his sons out into the wide world thought it his duty to entrust them to the protection and guidance of a man who was very celebrated at the time, and who, moreover, happened to be his best friend. "In like manner, I send my 6 sons to you, most celebrated and very dear friend. They are, indeed, the fruit of a long and laborious study. But the hope which many friends have given me that this toil will be in some degree rewarded encourages me and flatters me with the thought that these children may one day prove a source of consolation to me. During your last stay in this capital, you yourself, my very dear friend, expressed to me your approval of these compositions. Your good opinion encourages me to offer them to you, and leads me to hope that you will not consider them wholly unworthy of your favor. Please, then, receive them kindly, and be to them a father, guide, and friend. From this moment I surrender to you all my rights over them. I entreat you, however, to be indulgent to those faults which may have escaped a father's partial eye, and in spite of them, to continue your generous friendship towards one who so highly appreciates it. Meanwhile, I remain with all my heart, dearest friend, your most sincere friend." Since only a small portion of Mozart's works appeared in print during his lifetime, the publication of the 6 Haydn quartets in 1785 by Arteria and Company might be seen as recognition of their quality, yet there is little evidence that they aroused special interest in Mozart's lifetime. Haydn's words of praise remained Mozart's major solace.